Imagine your boss comes to you with the genome of a malaria parasite from an interland region that is wreaking havoc on the community, especially children under five. Your task is to sequence the DNA to see which species it is and ascertain as to whether it's different from the established and long recognized strain, or if it is some new strain that could be adding to the woes of the community. Knowledge is power, and securing this information may lead to insights that may be manipulated in the fight against the parasite. The genome size of the parasite is
23
megabases. Currently, the machines for sequencing DNA cannot sequence that long length of DNA in one hit. They typically can handle up to 600 base pairs. If we take DNA from complex genomes like that of humans and plants, for example, then we cannot sequence that with a single polymerase, DNA polymerase, understandably. DNA polymerases can only add nucleotides to a certain number of bases before it starts making mistakes and creating mismatches. Consequently, the input DNA must be fragmented into DNA pieces, tiny DNA pieces, before sequencing can begin. You have three choices for fragmenting the DNA. One, use enzymes that recognize specific nucleotide sequences and subsequently cuts them. These enzymes like restriction enzymes, transposases, or nicking enzymes. Or two, use divalent metal cations like zinc or even magnesium in combination with heat to shear the DNA. Thirdly, you may use acoustic sound to generate DNA into manageable pieces at random sites. Which will you choose? Choose carefully, because the method you use can have enormous consequences. Okay, I'm being extra dramatic, but no, the method you choose does matter. Let's look into it. If you go with restriction enzymes, the enzymes you select may either cut both strands of double-stranded DNA, so restriction endonucleases, or create nicks on each strand of double-stranded DNA. These methods offer you flexibility and can generate low base pairs or longer kilobases worth of sequences. But there will be a price to pay. The con is that you can have sequence biases due to its proclivity to cut at recognition sites only. If you go with physical fragmentation, your go-to method is sonication. Here, you use highly controlled and sophisticated acoustic waves to fragment the DNA. The acoustic waves create bubbles capable of generating high resonance vibrations that lead to breakage in DNA strands. The sound waves cut hydrogen bonds in DNA molecules, causing single and double-strand breaks. Depending on the sound energy, DNA can be broken into different sizes. For example, some acoustic devices can break DNA into 100 base pairs, up to 5,000 base pairs, 5 kilo base pairs. And others can do very long pieces at 6 to 60 kilo base pairs. The DNA sizes can be controlled by selecting the length of sonication, the cycle duty, the cycle burst. So here, let's take a look at an actual DNA fragmenting machine, the Covirus, and look at how that machine actually works. Some practical things. So taking a closer look at a real-life fragmentation device, a physical shearing device, you can see here there's a refrigerating component, and this is to ensure that you don't overheat your DNA while attempting to fragment it, because you're not trying to damage it, you're just trying to very focused and accurately shear your DNA. The next thing you need is the right vessel for placing your DNA into. Now, as mentioned, you may want like 100 base pair fragments, right up to 5,000 base pairs, or you may actually want 6,000 up to 20,000 base pairs, so kilobases worth. But you, depending on the length you're going for, they're determined vessels so that you can withstand the pressure that you're going to be applying. And so you go ahead and determine which one suits you for the particular length that you are going for. Accordingly, there are different sizes for holding the vessels. So you can see on the screen here, depending on the bigness, smallness of the vessel you're choosing, you select the appropriate holder. So if you're looking at the Covaris one here, the holder with the glass vessel insert is then placed into this slot as shown on the screen. The whole Covaris container would have been filled to a particular level of water, which is marked, depending, deionized water, mind you. Once that's all sorted, you want to turn on the software that will actually drive the program. So this is when you're gonna be selecting the actual program that you want to use, or creating the program you want to use in order to fragment your DNA. So you have to play with parameters such as the average incident power in watt, the peak incident power, the duty factor, the cycles or bursts that you are going for, and finally the duration, how long. And of course, the longer, the smaller the fragments that you're going to get. And so the software allows you to input what you need it to do, what you want the instrument to do. And so the quickest way to do it is to edit an existing program that the software gives you, so that you can go ahead and customize it for your particular fragment length. Before the program can start, it will degas the deionized water, and this is because it doesn't want anything in its way when it's creating the ultrasound waves. And so you will see these bubbles coming out, which indicates to you that it's working, it's degassing the deionized water. And so if you require refrigeration, depending on how long you are doing the output for, you would have turned on the refrigeration unit. And also it's the system for controlling the power, so you would turn on the power anyway. The price to pay with this method is that you need to play around and optimize the method that gives you a large proportion of desired fragments. So you need to have a lot of DNA, because you want to take some and play with it and make sure that at the end of your optimizations, you have the majority of your DNA fragments being the sizes that you wanted. If you've got very limited DNA and don't have the option of playing around, then you probably should go with the enzyme method. But there are biases in that. Your third option is to use divalent metal ions and heat to break nucleic acids. It can be used for DNA, but it tends to actually be used more for RNA. Now, by modifying the incubation time, fragments can be longer or shorter, with longer incubation giving you shorter fragments. So which of these methods are you going to choose after all this roundup? Let me know in the comments. Just so you know, because you obtain random fragmentation, sonication is the most widely adopted method of shearing DNA. You don't want some assessor coming to you and accusing you of bias in terms of what you sequenced. So after the process of fragmenting, however, whatever method you use, small pieces of DNA, aka oligonucleotides, called adapters, are then going to be ligated to your fragmented DNA. Now, these are called adapters because they allow the DNA to bind to flow cells used for sequencing. The DNA adapter molecules are now called a DNA library. And that brings us to the end of DNA fragmentation for sequencing purposes. If you found this video helpful, please let me know by giving the video a thumbs up. And if you haven't already joined the study group, please consider subscribing and joining this fun study group. All the best. God bless.